That will take us to another outstanding lecture, Parenteral Nutrition in Intensive Care, which is an interest for everybody now. Intensive care is full everywhere in the world, Egypt, Middle East, everywhere. And we are looking forward to listen to this lecture, Parenteral Nutrition. I would like, on your behalf, to welcome Prof. Emad for the second lecture, Extraordinary Night for Parenteral Nutrition. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Saad. We will second lecture today will be on total parenteral nutrition. ظهرت كده؟ Hello?
Yes, yes. Okay, please.
I will try to simplify a very complex subject. So I'll apply a simple and the practical approach that is very valuable, especially in resource-limited countries like Egypt. So what is TPN? Total parenteral nutrition is the administration of all nutrient requirements intravenously to a patient, to patients who are unable to fulfill their daily protein, calorie, and hydration requirements via the normal route, which is gastrointestinal tract. So the standard of nutrition in the ICU is the normal route, the gastrointestinal tract. When these patients are unable to receive their daily protein, calorie, and hydration requirements via this route, you need to supply it through the intravenous route. So before we start, it is important to understand that it is best to feed most patients through the enteral route whenever possible. Total parenteral nutrition provides no advantages and actually may increase morbidity and cost compared with enteral feeding in patients with a functioning gastrointestinal tract. This is very important. So indications for total parenteral nutrition are patients with nutritional requirements that cannot be met by enteral feeding, for more than 5 to 7 days. If the patient can have his normal feeding within 5 to 7 days, you shouldn't start TPN. You only start TPN if the patient is expected not to have his requirements via the gastrointestinal tract in 1 week. Such patients include those with short bowel syndrome, ودول بنشوفهم يمكن كتير اليومين دول ال MVO حالات دي كتيرة كترت ما عرفش ليه كده exacerbation of inflammatory bowel disease or pancreatitis, Crohn's, ulcerative colitis, and severe pancreatitis. Actually, the mainstay of pancreatitis is to feed the patient through the gastrointestinal tract as tolerated. But there in severe, very severe cases, there is a severe nausea and vomiting that is persistent for days, more than 5 to 7 days. In those cases, you need to supplement these patients with enteral feeding. Large foregut fistulas, more than 2 liters per day. Bone marrow transplant patients with mucositis or diarrhea who need bowel rest. Malnourished patients with malabsorption syndromes. And any patients who is expected to be NPO more than 5 to 7 days. There, we need to have some basic concepts before prescribing our TPN. So to write a proper TPN regime, it is essential to estimate, or better than estimate is to measure the daily energy and protein requirements of our patient. How to measure energy requirement? We measure energy requirement in the ICU using a very simple machine called indirect calorimetry. It is a module that is available in your monitor in the ICU, and it measures oxygen consumption, carbon dioxide production, respiratory quotient, and the total energy expenditure. It is the most accurate method available to measure the energy expenditure of your patient. So you don't need to calculate the calories. And the equation used by this machine is the one written in front of you. The second method for energy requirement is to predict the energy requirements of this patient. A very simple method of prediction is to use the body weight. We calculate the basal energy expenditure by multiplying the body weight by 25 to give you the basal energy expenditure. And then you multiply this number by 20% more or 1.2 to give the total energy expenditure in a non-stressed patient. We will discuss certain adjustments. Or, you can use also Harris-Benedict equation, and there are two equations, one for men and one for women, and it utilizes the body weight and the height and age of the patient. And this energy expenditure, and you now multiply it by 1.2 to get the total energy expenditure. So this is the first component, which is the energy requirement. You need to do some adjustments. You need to do some adjustments in total energy expenditure to allow for enhanced energy expenditure in hyper metabolic conditions. The following corrections apply. If the patient is feverish, we add 10% more to the calculated requirements for each 1 degree centigrade above normal. And if the patient is having a mild stress, we add 20% more. If the patient moderate stress is 40% more, and severe stress up to 60% more energies may be required. And actually, when we use the indirect calorimetry, we find that some patients are having about double their energy requirement. This is their actual energy expenditure. The second component you need to measure is the protein requirements of your patients. The accurate method of measuring the protein requirement of the patient is to collect the 24-hour urine of this patient to measure the urine urea nitrogen. And the protein requirement of this patient equals the urine urea nitrogen multiplied by 6.25, because each gram nitrogen each gram nitrogen excreted in the urine is from a catabolism of 6.2 grams of protein. And then you add 4 to 6 to this number, depending on the patient weight. If the patient weight is less than 60 kilograms, you add 4 to this number. If the patient weight is more than 60 kilograms, you add 6 to this number. So this is the accurate method to measure the protein requirement of this patient, and in order to achieve what we call a zero nitrogen balance or a positive nitrogen balance, depending on the Nutri-Score of your patient. The predictive method is to use, again, the body weight, and we multiply the body weight by 1 to 2 grams. You see the range is very wide. Patients with 60% burn, for example, require very large amounts of proteins. So we multiply by 2. So this is a predictive method, is to multiply the body weight by 1 to 2 grams, depending on the catabolic state of the patient. Before starting TBN, you have to do a baseline. You have to measure baseline values of the patient, because TBN can produce significant metabolic changes to your patient. So we need to have baseline values for the electrolytes, sodium, potassium, chloride, bicarbonate, phosphate, magnesium, calcium, BUN, creatinine, fasting blood sugar, albumin, liver functions, complete blood picture with differential. These all should be taken before starting TPN. And we need to do a follow-up of the patient during the TPN. The lights and the glucose should be checked daily for 3 to 4 days until it's stable, then every other day. Renal function tests, calcium, magnesium, and phosphate should be checked every other day until it's stable, then twice a week. And liver function tests and the albumin should be checked every 10 to 14 days. So these are more frequent tests may be required for unstable patients depending on the clinical situation. So now, how to create a TBN? I will describe here a simple stepwise approach using a 60 kilogram adult patient as an example. Step one is to estimate the daily protein and the calorie requirement of this patient. He's a 60 kilos. We'll use the estimated methods until we measure the actual. So the protein requirements, we will multiply his body weight, say, by 1.4 grams. So this patient 60 kilogram multiplied by 1.4. So this is 84 grams of protein is required. Now the calorie requirement of this patient, we multiply also the body weight by 25. Then we suppose that this patient having a normal mild stress, we will multiply this by 1.2. So 60 by 25 by 1.2 will be 1800 kilocalorie. So now we know the protein and the calorie requirements of this patient. The second step is to make a standard, what we call standard TBN mixture solution. This is a mixing bag will contain 500 milliliter of a standard amino acid solution that's 10% plus 500 milliliter of dextrose 50%. So the final 1 liter will contain 5% amino acid and dextrose 25%. Yani each liter will contain 50 grams amino acids and 250 grams dextrose. Very simple. Now determine how much volume of this solution is required to supply the patient protein requirement. We said that this patient requires 84 grams of protein, and each liter of this mixture gives 50 grams, right? So how many liters is required of this standard mixture? I have 84 divided by 50, so 1.68 liter, that is 1,680 milliliter of the standard TBN mixture. We divide TBN must be given through a central line over 24 hours. So we divide this by 24, 1680 divided by 24 will give us 70 milliliter per hour. So this will be the rate of infusion. Okay, this is very simple for the first macro components, glucose, our energy, and protein. Okay, the third step is to determine how much calories this volume will give to the patient. Using an energy yield of 3.4 kilocalorie gram of dextrose, yani each gram of dextrose will give you 3.4 kilocalorie. So 1.68 colliliter every liter of this solution has 250 grams of dextrose. And each gram of dextrose gives 3.4 liter. So this standard mixture will give the patient 1,428 kilocalorie. But we calculated that this patient requires 1,800 kilocalorie. So there is here energy deficit you have to supply. So this patient still needs 372 kilocalories more. How to supply them? We supply them by fat. So these remaining calories can be supplied by intralipid or smooth lipid. Say and stamina smooth lipid. 20% lipid emulsion will yield 2 kilocalorie per milliliter. So this patient needs 186 milliliter of 20% smooth lipid mass to complete his calorie requirements. We can approximate this, but fish andina 168, and fish andina 200, fanit dilu 200. So we can approximate this to the nearest 50 to be 200 milliliter. Hanit dium over 10 hours, masalan, lipid D. فهياخد 20 milliliter per hour for 10 hours about 200 كده هو أخد البروتين requirement he has his total protein requirement and calorie requirement خلصنا كده؟ لا لسه بدر، هما دول اسهل حاجه. Step 5 دي very important. Determine the electrolytes, vitamins, and the trace element requirements. Because remember that TPN is a total nutrition. You have to supply these micronutrients. Otherwise, you will end up with severe electrolyte disturbance and your patient will die in few days. This is very tricky. So the current recommended range for electrolytes in TPN in adults are الصوديوم والبوتاسيوم قد بعض بالظبط 1 to 2 ملي equivalent بالكيلو جرام بير داي. انا احسبها ازاي؟ if the patient has a normal range of sodium say 135 to 145 يبقى this patient will need 1.5 ملي equivalent بير كيلو جرام of sodium. If his sodium is lower than 135, he will take the upper limit, which is 2 milli equivalent per kilogram per day. If his serum sodium is higher than 145, we will give him 1 milli equivalent per kilogram per day of sodium. Until that's why we need to measure the sodium and potassium daily in order to adjust our TPN daily. If the patient, his sodium is higher than 155, we don't give him that day sodium, but we have to re-measure sodium next day and add sodium again. Potassium the same. We think that the normal range of potassium is 4 to 5.5. So if he is in 4, his serum sodium potassium is from 4 to 4.5, he will have 1.5 milli equivalent per kilogram per day of potassium. يعني لو هو 60 كيلو هياخد 90 ملي equivalent of potassium per day. اوكي لو هو less than 4 هديله، لو هو من 3.5 to 4.5 هياخد 2 ملي equivalent per kilogram per day. لو هو اكتر من 4 من 5.5 to 6 هنديله 2 ملي 1 ملي equivalent per kilogram per day. لو هو اكتر من 6 will miss البوتاسيوم this day and repeat second day and adjust accordingly. In this, you see that sodium and potassium are nearly equal, and this is very important. Chloride. The chloride requirements is 1 to 1.5 milli equivalent per kilogram per day. And here is you have the problem. If you give your sodium and potassium as chloride, each milli equivalent of sodium has 1 milli equivalent of chloride and potassium the same. So if you give the patient say 1.5 milli equivalent of sodium and 1.5 milli equivalent of potassium as chloride, you will end up with 3 milli equivalent per kilogram per day of chloride. This will cause hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis and renal failure in 10 to 15 days. So in this, and this is the biggest problem in giving TPN in Egypt. We have limited choices, and I'll discuss later how we solve this problem. Acetate is 0.2 to 0.5 milli equivalent per kilogram per day, and magnesium is 8 to 15 milli equivalent per day. And the calcium is 5 to 20 milli equivalent per day. You have to supplement all these requirements every day for the patient in your TPN mixture. You have to add to this vitamins and trace elements. So you have to add two multivitamin vials should be added daily. One containing water-soluble vitamins, vitamin B1, B2, B3, B6, B12, bantocinic acid, biotin, and folic acid, and vitamin C. And the other vial contains the fat-soluble vitamins, A, D, E, and K. All these vitamins must be supplied daily for the patients for TPN. Also, you have to supply a trace element vial that should be added daily. It contains zinc, cobalt, iron, selenium, manganese, chromium, and cobalt and iodine. So you see how complex is TPN? You have to add all this in order to avoid electrolyte and vitamin deficiencies and disturbances. Now, how can you administer sodium, potassium, and chloride in Egypt? This is the solution I have reached. As I told you, if you give potassium and sodium as chloride, you will end up by hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis and renal failure in 10 to 15 days. In order to avoid that, I give potassium as potassium chloride. Of course, in England and in Gulf and in Saudi Arabia, we have other forms of sodium and potassium. We have sodium acetate and sodium phosphate and sodium chloride. We have potassium acetate, potassium phosphate, and potassium chloride. Unfortunately, in Egypt, we don't have this luxury, but you have to go around to do this. Sodium is given as sodium lactate. We have, fortunately, a solution called 6-molar sodium lactate. Sodium lactate have sodium and lactate, and the lactate is metabolized in the liver, as you know, to carbon dioxide and water. So that's nice. So you have only here sodium, you don't have chloride with it. And each liter of this solution, that is each liter contains 167 milliequivalent of sodium. So this patient will need 90 milliequivalent of sodium. So he will require 539 milliliter per day of sodium lactate. So we use sodium lactate to supplement sodium. And you use sodium chloride, potassium chloride to supplement potassium. But remember that the chloride requirement, as we said, is half to 1 milliequivalent, while the potassium requirement is 1 to 2 milliequivalent. So you potentially giving an overdose of chloride to this patient, but it is a minimal overdose, not like a 3 or 4 times overdose if we use your potassium and sodium as chloride, which is very dangerous, really. So potassium chloride here, we can add it usually to the dextrose 50, and the fat-soluble vitamins can be added to intralipid, and water-soluble vitamins and trace elements are added to the sodium lactate. So this is how to give the mixture. Okay, how can you administer sodium, potassium, and the chloride in Egypt? This is another solution, actually, we can use, and it is an easy solution. Although the smooth captivin, which is one of the products of Fresenius, was initially invented for peripheral parenteral nutrition, but you can use it as a replacement to total parenteral nutrition if the patient does not have a volume restriction. There are two bags of this. There are the big bag, which is 19, almost 2 liter bag, and there is one or 1200 milliliter bag. The 1900 milliliter bag contains 1350 kilocalorie, and the small bag contains 850 kilocalorie. And this bag contains all the electrolytes and the calorie and the trace elements and proteins the patient require in one bag, and you mix this bag together to make the TBN bag. So you may give this patient two small bags if he requires 1700 kilocalorie, or one large bag and one small bag if he requires, for example, 2000 kilocalorie or so. And add to it the IV intravenous vitamins, one water soluble and one fat soluble, and also one trace element. And this is a second solution to the problem of sodium and chloride in Egypt. So now there are some special clinical situations that we need to consider in giving TBN. For example, patients with renal failure. Amino acid solutions used in patients suffering from chronic renal failure contain more essential amino acids, 89%, compared to the 50% in the standard amino acid solution. So there are special amino acid solutions that you can use in order to supplement your protein, the patient protein requirement, if he is suffering from TPN, from chronic renal failure, like in kidman or in HIBA, or kidman is a type of amino acid solution that contains here a higher content of essential amino acid solution, and the nitrogen in essential amino acids is partially recycled for the production of non-essential amino acids, thus leading to less production and rise of blood urea nitrogen. So these patients will suffer less uremia if you use this type of solution. Also, patients with hepatic failure and hepatic insufficiency, we use amino acid solutions with a higher content of branched chain amino acids, isoleucine and leucine and valine. These antagonize the uptake of aromatic amino acids like the tryptophan into the CNS, and thus help prevent the subsequent breakdown of aromatic amino acids to form false neurotransmitters, which have been implicated in the pathogenesis of hepatic encephalopathy. Examples in HEBA amino acid. So we prefer to use amino acid solutions with a higher branched chain amino acid, اللي هي بتبقى 46% versus the standard amino acids, زي الامينوستيريل مثلا, بيحتوي على 25% of branched chain amino acid. If we use a higher content of branched chain amino acid, that be lower instance of hepatic encephalopathy in patients with liver failure or liver dysfunction. Few words on the peripheral parenteral nutrition. It is useful for patients who require partial nutritional support for short periods. The post-operative patients who are expected to be NPO for a few days. The goal here is to provide just enough non-protein calorie to spare the breakdown of muscle proteins to provide energy. We know, you have to understand that calories or caloric requirements has a priority on nitrogen or anabolism of the patient. So if you don't supply enough calories to the patient, he will destroy his own resources. He will first destroy consume the glycogen in the liver, and this probably consumed in all critically ill patients, and then he will start to break down the muscle by gluconeogenesis to form to glucose in order to burn it. فالidea of peripheral parenteral nutrition ان انا اديله بس enough calories to prevent this breakdown of the muscle. We call it muscle wasting or muscle asthenia. Allowed solutions in peripheral veins are those with osmolarity less than 900 milliosmol. فاي solution with osmolarity less than 900 milliosmol, you can give it through a peripheral line. Now, if you give a higher osmolarity in the peripheral line, it will thrombose and close. These solutions lose dextrose 5%, dextrose 10%, amino acids 1.5%, and intralipid 10 and 20%. Smooth captivin is an easy to give ready-made formula. This is one of the A solutions you can give in the peripheral line. A common admixture here is amino acid 3% plus dextrose 50%. 2.5 liter mil mixture da hayadini amino acid 25%, 1.5% with dextrose 10%. لو انت اديت العين 2.5 liter دول هيدوك 850 kilocalorie. If we add to this 500 milliliter of intralipid 10%, this will give almost 1,350 kilocalorie, just enough calories to satisfy basal energy requirement of the patient. طيب, إيه بقى خطورة أو potential disadvantages of TPN? أول حاجة, complications of central venous access. إحنا قلنا TPN must be given through a central line. ف You have to insert a central line. Complications of central access: immediate pneumothorax, air embolism, vascular nerve injury, hemothorax, arrhythmias, loss of catheter integrity, delayed thrombosis, arteriovenous malformation, pulmonary embolism, infection, hyperglycemia. All patients having TBN, a full TBN feeding, will produce hyperglycemia. If the patient is not diabetic, he will gradually have a normal glucose tolerance. And this is very important when you stop the TBN. Don't stop it suddenly. Otherwise, you will get a fatal hypoglycemia, because the insulin surge will cause fatal hypoglycemia. So you have to stop it gradually and decrease the concentration of dextrose. So a full TBN will produce hyperglycemia, and this will be more intense in a diabetic patient. So insulin is usually added directly to the TBN, 10 to 20 units, and a separate insulin infusion is frequently required to assess the body own insulin production to achieve euglycemia. You have to attach a separate insulin pump to most patients having total parenteral nutrition, especially if these patients are diabetic. Glucose tolerance improves and the insulin requirements usually decrease over time in non-diabetics. So non-diabetics usually don't require insulin after a few days. A target random blood sugar of 80 to 180 per deciliter is recommended in the critically ill. We are not very tight, 70 to 110, except if there is severe sepsis. But in most critically ill patients, we maintain the blood sugar between 80 and 100. Insulin is an anabolic hormone. It's very important. The second or the third complication that we face is hypophosphatemia. Phosphate goes into the cells with dextrose. So when you start the TBN to the patient, glucose will enter the cell and will take with it phosphate. So dangerous hypophosphatemia can happen. This effect is due to enhanced uptake of phosphate into the cell associated with glucose entry. وطبعا الانسولين هو is the one that takes the glucose and the phosphate into the cell. It's usually serum phosphate level returns to normal values after few weeks of TPN. Fatty liver is also a potentially common complication for TPN. When glucose calories exceed the total energy expenditure, there is lipogenesis in the liver, which may progress to fatty infiltration. So it's very important not to overfeed your patient. Hypercapnia, although this has been attributed to the high respiratory quotient associated with carbohydrate metabolism, it's usually a reflection of overfeeding in general. So this is another complication of overfeeding. Of course, the cost of TBN is high. It is at least two to 10 times more and require more lab tests than enteral feeding. Well, I'll give you some reflections on TBN. Remember that the goal of nutrient intake in the malnourished patient is to correct the malnutrition. However, malnutrition that accompanies critical illness is different from that which accompanies simple starvation. This difference has important implications for the value of nutrient intake in each situation. The malnutrition in the critically ill is not only due to inadequate food intake, but also due to disease-induced abnormal nutrient processing. Critical illness itself produces abnormal nutrient processing. And it doesn't mean that you are going to supply the important nourishments that you corrected the malnutrition. You decreased the malnutrition, but the most important here is to reverse the critical illness itself. So thus, nutrient intake will not fully correct this type of malnutrition as long as the underlying disease is active. Thus, the important factor in correcting malnutrition is not only the intake of nutrients, but also a decrease in the activity of the underlying disease process. TBN must include all nutritional components and be delivered continuously over 24 hours, usually via a central line. Okay, to conclude, TBN is indicated for malnourished patients, severely catabolic patients, trauma, burns, sepsis, cancer patients, and patients with organ failure without a functioning gastrointestinal tract. Special nutritional support is not indicated for well-nourished surgical patients with uncomplicated surgery who will have a limited period of fasting, 2 to 4, 5, 6, even 7 days. Madam, he is very well nourished. If nutritional support is indicated, it should be initiated as soon as possible. TBN is usually infused in a central line continuously over 24 hours. TBN tries to simulate gastrointestinal functions as regards satisfying the body nutritional requirements, including macro and micronutrients. The benefits and risks should be carefully calculated for each individual patient. Once the GIT recovers, it should be the ideal route for feeding critically ill patients. Thank you. Shukran.
Thank you so much, Professor Emad Abdel-Ghaffar. Thank you. Really,
I hope it is very fantastic
lectures. And the two subjects are very, very important. I think no exam will be, no questions in the exam away from the total parenteral nutrition or the muscle relaxants, sure. Even the written exam or in the oral exam. Very important subjects. And excuse me, Dr. Saad, I'll take the questions of the lectures related to the muscle relaxant, and I leave the floor for you to discuss with Professor Abdel-Ghaffar for the parenteral nutrition. We have some of the questions, Prof. Emad. One question is, how can I detect the value of supramaximal stimulation?
Okay, very nice. Most of the machines we have now, for example, the one in the Datix or the GE machine, it starts, it detects itself automatically, the supramaximal. How? It starts by 10 amperes, then 20 amperes, 40 amperes, and detects the, in a single twitch, the response, okay? And it measures the response until you get a maximal response. Say we got the maximal response at 50 milliampere. Then it will go above it 25%. So 50 milliampere will give you 25, so 12, it will be 65 milliampere, and we'll use this as the supramaximal response, okay? Extra. So this is how to get it.
Okay, perfect. The second question is about how many of the twitches required for extubation if we are using post-tetanic stimulation, besides, of course, the clinical evaluation.
Okay, you shouldn't actually extubate a patient on post-tetanic. As I said, post-tetanic is like an ultrasound that detects how deep is the submarine. And at the end of surgery, you should have some twitches. This means that you're maintaining very deep block until the end, which is not very good. You should never reverse your patient on a post-tetanic. Post-tetanic count means that there is no single twitch. The train of four is zero. Train of four count is zero. Then you do a post-tetanic count. You got me? So you should never reach this point. At the end of surgery, and you have till the end, okay? So I don't advise anybody to reverse to reverse on post tetanic count unless it is urgent. Sometimes
so
it is
so urgent. Depending on the train of four.
And you have to use the train of four and wait until the train of four ratio is 10%. This means that you have the four twitches.
Okay.
You have the four twitches and you get a four ratio of 10%. Then you give your nystagmine. But if you are using arachronium, and you have sugar medix, okay, then you can reverse on a post tetanic count.
Okay,
this is the only exception. In this case, you will need a post tetanic count at least of two or three, okay, and you give at this time 16 milligrams per kg of sugar medix.
Yes, sir. So okay. We came to the questions of what is the best monitor of muscle relaxant intraoperative?
The best is train of four.
Train of four.
Okay. For example, if you are doing a laparoscopic surgery or a thoracic surgery, and you need a moderate degree of block, then you keep your train of four count between two and three. That is the train of four ratio is zero. Okay. But you have a count. You have a train of four count of two to three. Okay. So this is an acceptable type of block for thoracic or abdominal surgery or laparoscopic abdominal surgery. If you are doing a limb surgery, you don't need that deep block. It's very deep. And you don't need this relaxation at all. You may need it to intubate the patient, but not to maintain the surgery. Why you need a relaxation in a patient undergoing total hip, for example, or total knee?
Yes.
And this is my idea. And I don't like paralyzing a conscious patient. This is really not good.
If you allow me, sir, to ask a question from me, I think I have the right to ask you and to... Take advantage that you are here, and I hope to share with us many, many times, and to have times to share with us with other lectures. But specifically for the muscle relaxants, I know that you are interested in the neuro anesthesia, and luckily I am your student in this field. Of anesthesia, and I like neuro anesthesia. And we are. Thank you, sir. I am spending, believe me, Prof, in transnasal tumor resection nowadays in our institute for more than 16 or 18 hours. And I am using a muscle relaxant as induction agent, and after that, we are using total TIVA.
TIBN, yeah. TIVA. Yeah.
Legally, I am speaking legally, specifically
yeah.
in Gulf area, because you know mm-hmm. the problems of court and asking and blah, 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 blah. I am giving rucronium in the beginning as intubation. Shall I give relaxant, muscle relaxant reversal at the end of all of this time, very long time, and the patient is spontaneously breathing, provided, Prof, I am not using muscle relaxant monitoring, unfortunately. I am lazy. I am not using.
Yes. بس
yes.
أنا يمكن آخر مرة استعملت ريفرسل مش فاكر من كم سنة.
We have a lot of we are speaking English.
And,
so please.
Yeah. I am one of those anesthesiologists who rarely use reversal.
Yes.
Use reversal. But because I have been using NMT for a very long time, so I'm pretty confident that this patient is totally recovered. So, long time that this patient is about, you give an intubating dose, say 1.2 milligram of
ropivacaine. So no need to give muscle relaxant provided.
If then the surgery is more than 3 hours, and 3 hours, that is, I would say, three times the ED, maximum ED, maximum ED, half elimination half life of the drug, half of the drug. I don't. انا سامع ايكو جامد في ال جامد في ال في ال مش عارف ليه.
الو everything is fine, all mics are closed.
ايوه
all mics are closed.
اوكي
everything should be fine.
انا فوق اوكي يو بروف عصام. And I would tell you that I will do the same. I would reverse بعد المدة الطويلة after this all time. But for medical legal purposes, I will do this yes. with a proper NMT monitor.
Excellent.
Monitor.
طب, sir, last questions for me. Two points. And sir, this question had been asked in our panel. The first one asked the brain needs muscle relaxant or not. This is number one. Number two, is the neuromuscular monitoring is approved FDA? I mean, is it standard monitoring? FDA, we should analyze every case like CO2 or entitled CO2. What is the situation in USA or Europe? Thank you, sir.
The first question, I heard the part of it. Do you mean muscle relaxation is important to relax the brain? This was the question.
Yes.
Relax. Is it important to relax the brain? Okay.
To use muscle.
معلش الصوت في حاجة مشكلة. إيش اسمه؟ Do you hear me?
Internet connection is on and out.
Okay. The intracranial pressure has no relationship to muscle relaxation. Cranial relaxation. The most important factors in controlling the intracranial pressure are the perfusion pressure, of the brain, which is the blood pressure minus the central or the intracranial pressure. And so it's the venous drainage of the brain is free. And the capnograph, your CO2 is good, is not high, is low normal. And the hemodynamics of the patient is okay. This is the most important to relax the brain. And also, as you know, using the brain, using the TEVA also increases the brain vasoconstriction and using ICP, and minimizing the inhalation to a half or one or 0.7 mac supplement to TEVA. This seven man to 10 are the most sent. Doesn't relax the skull. Important adequate depth of anesthesia, because you know intracranial surgery is usually done under microscope, and any small movement will be. And any small movement will be like an earthquake or mic movement and any small like an earthquake. So if you are not confident of the depth of anesthetic, just you have to, and most, I understand that most anesthetists will give a muscle relaxer. But this level, giving anesthesia, few anesthesiologists in the world do it. Few neuro anesthesiologists.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. And I hope it will not be the last picture and the floor for Professor Saad. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prof. Assam, and thank you, Prof. Ahmed. And we have Dr. Adil here. I will give him the seat for asking. Dr. Adil, we can go ahead. Thank you. Adil, unmute yourself. Okay.
Thank you very much, Dr. Assam, Dr. Ahmed. Really, very fruitful night with your knowledge and experience. I'm not sure much, if you, it is my honor to first time to listen to you and Dr. Manaa at the same time. Can you give us please a practical point, which clinical point you can do without using an EMT when recovery in the recovery room? As you know, some hospitals don't have the neuromuscular monitoring. What's the most important clinical tool can do to make sure the patient already recovered?
The clinical tools that they use a tongue depressor, for example, to hold if the patient can sustainly hold the tongue depressor or sustain the head lift for 12 seconds and so on. But of course, these are really clinical. But all the studies prove that they fail to match the objective monitoring. And I don't understand why it is underutilized. It is a cheap and available and easily used modality.
Yeah, NMT now is the standard of the American.
Yes.
American.
Since 5 years now.
Standard, yeah. Used NMT.
Yeah. Once you use a muscle relaxant, you have to use a monitor for this.
Okay, Dr. Adil, can we go to for the TPN question? Just to need to conclude very shortly, please.
What is the percentage of carbohydrate lipids and usually and in ventilated patients?
Okay, it was so that. If you give a higher percentage of carbohydrate, you will end up with a higher CO2 output, and this can be a problem. Actually, it is not. In ICU, the main source now, the current, so Isbin or Asbin, the main source of calorie is dextrose in TBN. Okay? You may add fat. You may add fat, but you have to add the minimum amount of fat in order to supply essential fatty acid requirements. But the old thinking that patients with chest conditions, with so and so, you will, if you add more carbohydrate, you will add a higher carbon dioxide load, and this can potentially aggravate a respiratory failure, is no longer holding.
You mean even a COPD patient?
Yes, of course. It's not. It's not. Yeah, okay.
How to calculate? You want to add any more points for that?
There's one question here.
Let's go to the next question. What is how to measure the TBN in obese patient, especially for lean?
As I said, the most accurate is to measure it, okay? If the patient is in ICU, we can measure by indirect calorimetry. This is a small module that is available in all ICUs, okay? You attach it to the exhaust port of the ventilator, and it measures the energy production of this patient. We attach it for 3 hours twice a week to the patient to measure his total energy expenditure. And the other side is nitrogen. We collect 24-hour urine, and we send it to the lab to get us the urine urea nitrogen. And then we have calorie and the nitrogen. And then we adjust that. We give the patient this. This is the most accurate measure. If you want to initially prescribe for an obese patient, I use what we call adjusted body weight. Adjusted body weight is the ideal body weight. The patient say 170 centimeter and he's 170 kilograms. So the ideal body weight of this patient is 70, okay? So the difference between 70 and 170 is 100 kilos. You get 30% of this and add it to the ideal body weight to be the adjusted body weight. And you calculate this for this patient, say it will be about 105 kilograms. And you calculate you estimate his nutritional requirements to be 105 kilograms. If he is 170, you got it? We call this adjusted body weight. Until you do the measurement, of course. The measurement is the most accurate.
More time for
few more seconds. We can enjoy presence of Prof Emad and Prof Essam as much as we can. Thank you.
Okay. When to give albumin and what's the frequency of monitoring in this case?
Albumin?
Yeah.
I never give albumin. You only give albumin if the patient is having, for example, paracentesis. Albumin decreases as what we call a fast responder. All critically ill patients have hypoalbuminemia. And in order to reverse hypoalbuminemia, you have to reverse critical illness and properly nourish the patient. Don't give albumin. Albumin has no value in the critical illness. You shouldn't give. Treating albumin, giving albumin to treat albumin is not the problem. You have to treat what causes hypoalbuminemia, not to give albumin.
So I really
use albumin ICU.
Thank you.
Dr. Adel, excuse me, there is one important question for Prof. Ahmed.
Sure.
In mechanically ventilated patients,
yes.
Do you rely on lipids or carbohydrates?
Now this question was asked by Professor Adel.
Okay. Sorry. Okay.
The in TBN, and I said the ideal, more all patients in ICU, we feed them through the enteral feeding. And the enteral is diet, is food, you know, ready-made formulas. That is a mixed polymers, you know. But if you have to give TBN, the main source of calories in TBN is dextrose. Whether the patient is in a ventilator, he is respiratory failure, he is whatever. Okay, the old cinema that if you give more carbohydrate, you will end up with a higher CO2 load, and this can increase respiratory failure. It's no longer holding.
So, what is the role of a dietitian in TPN, Prof? One more question.
The dietitian is the one who calculates the requirements, patient requirements. Yani if not all ICU physicians can prescribe TBN. Not all of them understand the principles or studied it, you know. In these cases, you rely on your dietitian, on critical care dietitian. But you may be better than him if you know the principles.
Okay, Dr. Ahmed, you know, as you said, the topic of the TBN is very critical and should be managed curiously. Do you have a recommendation, like a weaning or a method to minimize the side effect of stoppage of the TBN?
Yeah, as I said, never stop TBN suddenly. Otherwise, you will get a fatal hypoglycemia. So once the GIT recovers, you are going to feed the patient via the GIT. GIT is the gastrointestinal tract, is the best method to feed any patient. When you stop TBN, you have to stop gradually. Usually we give dextrose 10%, okay, for a few hours. And of course, stop the insulin infusion if we are using it, and monitor the blood sugar every hour, okay? Because these patients go into a severe hypoglycemia if you stop it suddenly, yeah. So you shouldn't stop it suddenly.
I think we have a great night tonight, and I'm so proud as one of the people working in this program to host four professors of anesthesia tonight. Prof. Emad Abdel-Ghaffar, thank you very much for coming on board, and Prof. Essam, Manaa, thank you much for inviting the great professor, Dr. Emad, and Prof. Adel, thank you much for coming on board for moderation as well. Dr. Waleed Aswa is my colleague here, and Dr. Hisham Maksud is another colleague for working in this program. We are so proud for this work tonight. I believe we did very well, because it deserves an extraordinary night to host Prof. Emad Abdel-Ghaffar, and we are so grateful for him to come tonight to give us outstanding two lectures, muscle relaxant and parenteral nutrition, never been given before. I never listened to this before like that. I really enjoyed them, and I believe all my colleagues did the same. I can't convey all the message and thanks for the gratitude for all my colleagues to Prof. Essam Manaa, and of course, Prof. Emad Abdel-Ghaffar and Prof. Adel to come here tonight. And thank you very much. And hopefully, the last message, Prof. Emad, I would like to ask your permission, because we are going to develop all of those lectures in PDF format to help our colleagues and our candidates. I would be grateful. I will come back to ask you for those two distinguished lectures and the first two lectures to be in the PDF book to help all our colleagues coming for the exam and feeling all this idea. Thank you much, everybody, and very nice to have all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Saad. I'm really honored to speak in front of all this great body.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Professor. Yeah. Thanks, Prof. Adel. Thanks, my colleague, Dr. Waleed.
Thank you, Prof. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.